Okay, let's line up. Face the flag. Let's let Joseph get the smaller ones in the front where they can see.
Can I just get lit?
Stand up straight. I pledge allegiance, to the flag,
to the
United States of America, and to the Republic, for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty, and justice for all. Let's pray. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we pray you bless us in school today. Bless us to have open eyes and open ears that we might hear your word. Thank you for this nice day. In Jesus' name, amen. Mm-hmm. One at a time, single file.
History, countries and kingdoms have been birthed on the battlefield of a revolutionary movement. Such crusades have been championed by soldiers and citizens who refuse to be denied or delayed or detoured in their pursuit to take up a cause they believe deserving of even death itself. This revolution, and that's what it is. It's not for the timid and the weak, but for the brave and the strong who stepped over the line, out of their comfort zone, and truly decided to become disciples of Christ.
Focused on the war on terror.
And he has a glorious hope for you in the days straight ahead that goes far beyond the scope of impending apocalypse.
I have been expecting for decades have finally arrived.
That fear can lead many people
to brief the administration on end of days scenario.
Might be wiped off the map, leading to all out.
Are we really at the end of the world?
Does the president believe these are the end of days?
You're talking about bombing Mecca, the church.
That we are living in the last days.
Every company in America should be on its knees thanking Jesus for being
raised up America to be a tool in that these last days
of America
to get the gospel to the
uttermost
parts of the earth.
So you don't experience it tomorrow.
This larger family of believers working together for a common goal was something that I had always dreamed that could exist, but had never seen it before this time. A place of refining in order to hear God, the voice of God, that's what we were about in those days. That we would be refined, the impurities in us would come out so that we would get to this place of perfection and hear the voice of God, the still small voice of God for ourselves. You know, this is where I'm going to spend the rest of my life. You know, my children are going to grow up in this environment of not having to worry about drugs, of not having to worry about getting kidnapped, no sexual abuse. I have never experienced anything like it before and or after.
I was born in Illinois, and I lived in Texas for several years. And then in the late 60s, God began to deal with us about the economic judgment, collapse, and upheaval that was coming upon all the world, and especially on this country. And he began to deal with us in the church that I was part of at that time down there to get out of the city.
Because he believed that the end days were coming, that what God was showing him was that the salvation of the United States and the world was these communities that people could come to. That was what his vision was. That's what he was preparing for. We need to store up food, we need to store up clothing, and in the meantime, before this happens, we ourselves need to be disciplined and listen to the Lord, and everything needed to be like school for learning what was going to happen down the road so that the people could learn from us when they got there.
We are trying to prepare a place as a refuge for people to come. We're storing food and clothes, and of course I can't tell you where or how much, but we're preparing.
During that little time period, I came across a tape by a man named John Todd. And Todd talked about this conspiracy going in the United States and across the world of people who were out to do away with the sovereignty of the United States.
The question is, how do we as Christians prepare for the coming days in regard to our necessity supply, food, fuel, etc.? When you're stocking up supplies, don't be like a lot of Christian retreats that are going to be stocking up supplies for looters to come and kill you so that they can eat. Start with the first thing. Start with something that will stop somebody from coming through the door and killing everybody in your family. Now, people say, can Christians do that? Killing and defending is two different things. Go read Esther 8.
And I guess we had never really thought in those terms. So it just seemed like a logical step. If we're going to prepare, if we're going to take people in, if we believe we're going to be here during the tribulation period, yes, it makes sense that we need to protect ourselves as well as protect others. So the next 18 months, we spent $52,000 on guns and ammunition and military equipment, started training.
Multiculturalism, the emergence of different groups, uppity women, gays, taking political and social power, all of these elements that seem to corrode that secure, certain view of a Christian world, men often take upon themselves a sense of personal obligation, that they have somehow failed, they haven't stood up, they haven't fought manfully in order to protect that culture, that civilization.
Since I'd grown up, you know, being bullied, this was the first time that somebody taught me how to defend myself. So it gave me a sense of power for the first time in my life.
And for him to see the world at war gave him a role, made him a soldier.
Basis of the philosophy of the right-wing movement, or even the Christian right, is that here we are at this point in time, and somewhere down the road, tribulation's coming, and the Antichrist is going to make war either on Israel, if you are a Christian that believes in the rapture, or in terms of the right-wing movement, just making war on Christians in general. So if you believe that that's what the Bible talks about, and that it's inevitable that it's going to occur, that means we're not going to go from point A to point C just overnight. Steps have to be made to get us to that point.
Multitudes, multitudes in the valley of the sea. me that we were living in the last days, and that the judgments of God and the completion of the plan of God was about to come forth in the earth. And he told me what a privileged generation and a privileged people we were, because all the holy prophets of our people that have lived before us have desired and looked into these things and would have given anything they had to have lived in this day.
Perhaps the most salient characteristic of Ellison was his ability to forge a new identity for others, his ability to help others feel that they are participating in a campaign to purify the world.
In December 1980, the timber market started shutting down with the recession in the country, and we had to find new ways of supporting ourselves. The leader of the group went to work off the property for about 3 or 4 months and left the paramilitary guy in charge. It just went right to his head. And I can remember one night in a meeting, he got up and said, if God doesn't start the war, then I'm going to.
I don't like to set dates, but it's feeling kind of spooky. And it might be tomorrow or sometime in 82, but it could last another 10 years, but I don't think so. The Bible says it's going to wax worse and worse. And when you go into these big cities and there are streets that you can't walk down without being thumped, you know it's getting bad. When homosexuality is in open view and not hidden anymore, you know it's getting bad. When witchcraft and communism is everywhere, you know it's getting bad.
When the leader of the group came back to the compound, he brought some information with him from a preacher that he had met in Missouri. And it was a teaching called Identity. This was something that we had been introduced to before and had rejected a few months earlier because it was strictly from the racial hate aspect. But the material that he brought back this time approached it from a patriotic point of view, from a America's heritage, from God point of view. And so that had more appeal to us.
The members of the covenant, the sword and the arm of the Lord, eventually accepted an identity Christian teaching that America is sacred territory and that the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution were God-given documents, that they were sacred. It was important for them to take America back from those non-Christians who were desecrating it.
Seeing why God had blessed America really made us feel more important, I guess. You know, before we kind of saw ourselves as elect by grace, but now the term was also elect by race. The Declaration of Independence and the Constitution became more real. Once we accepted identity, certain things had to change.
As you know, we have our own army, and I feel like the Lord's blessed it. He's ordained it.
It is our responsibility as Christians to survive the coming hard times. Amen?
Amen.
I have said for years that if God does not judge this nation and put the rod of correction on this nation, then he's going to have to resurrect Sodom and Gomorrah and apologize, because this nation is guilty before God. And queers and being accosted by thieves and robbers. And when they get caught, they might spend the night in jail. Because the laws of God have been forsaken.
All of these things that they see as just kind of, in one sense, annoying, but as signs that things are not right, are explained by an ideology that gives clarity and gives them power. Now they can do something about it. Now they understand it, because understanding is itself a form of power. But they can do something about it. They can become soldiers for God.
Thank you, Jesus. Lord, this teach us your ways of war. Teach us how to love and how to hate.
ultimately we built a place called Silver City, which was a four-block mock town in order to learn urban warfare.
We've given up everything we own on a large scale. We've given up our lives and our big jobs. We've offered ourselves up to try to save America.
We took Silhouette City, made that into a survival school, and taught people all around the country.
Three. Four.
I wrote a book called Prepare War, which talked about the scriptural basis for going to war. Of course, a lot of Old Testament scriptures, but some New Testament scriptures as well. That it was our duty, our calling to go to war, and what kind of scenario that we saw in the future as far as the trials and tribulations. Put out a booklet that was about the Constitution and the Declaration and how it should be interpreted from a Christian point of view. We intensified everything. We practiced everything. And that became a model for other groups.
There are people on this earth who are out to do evil, and they cannot do good. They want to pour out more drugs into this earth. They want to pour out the pornography, the humanistic junk that's in our teachings today. Those type of people are going to have to go one way or another, whether it's fire from heaven or fire from a barrel. They're going to have to go.
That we can ever hope to change or to abolish or to alter this government at all is if we unite strong enough together.
We decided that we needed to have all the different groups to come together and try to bring forth a national organization.
We've got to get ourselves ready spiritually first to know the truth of God to the best of our ability, and to commit our lives to Him, and to commit our families to Him, and to commit our fortunes and our futures and everything we've got to Him, because without that we won't make it. Our forefathers did it. Read what they pledged to one another, their fortunes and their sacred honor and their lives, and they meant it. I know my family's in danger, and I love them. I love all my children. But if I have to sacrifice my children for what God's doing, I'll have to do it, because He'll take them anyway if He wants them.
On April 19th of 1985, the federal government surrounded our property, started a four-day standoff. I became the negotiator between our group and the government.
Some of the members of CSA wanted to shoot it out with the feds, and they became even more entrenched and extreme in their views and willing to take very extreme risks.
Come Saturday morning and the state police begin to move. It's something that's been expected for days, ever since the state police and FBI closed in earlier this week, making their presence known to members of a militant political group, the Covenant, the Sword, and the Arm of the Lord. They brought in the heavy firepower from the air, and on the ground began preparing for guerrilla-style warfare.
Here at the entrance, Eyewitness News was met by Kerry Noble, a CSA elder. Noble says he doesn't want a confrontation, but if authorities storm the camp, there will be war.
If they wanted to make war, yeah.
And I want to bring you a word from God tonight. I pray that God will anoint me with this word, because as a people, we need to know the will of God. We need to know that this is the last hour. We need to know that this book, this holy Bible, is the word of God, and that every word in it is true. We need to know that God has set down in this book everything that we need, right down to the rules of warfare, right down to the way that you choose good soldiers and bad soldiers, right down to the way that you live and exist and have your being.
The apocalyptic is originally a religious vision, though it can take political form. It's a vision of absolute purification, of bringing about or undergoing the necessity of the end of the world or world destruction so that human beings can be renewed.
I really believe that the pagans and the abortionists and the feminists and the gays and the lesbians who are actively trying to make that an alternative lifestyle, all of them who tried to secularize America, I point the finger in their face and say, you helped this happen.
They could point to 9/11 and say, look, we told you something like this was going to happen. We told you that the end of the world was coming, there'd be a great confrontation, and see? Something like this has never happened before, and now it's happening. And now you should listen to us. Now you should take note that our message has a meaning. We were able to foretell these kinds of apocalyptic powers of destruction.
When all of the colonies had been established over here, they got together for the first time in 1643 and wrote what is known as the New England Confederation. And in that, they stated these words. Listen to them carefully. Whereas we all came into these parts of America for one and the same end and aim, namely, to advance the kingdom of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Today, on the Coral Ridge Hour, Dr. Kennedy reminds us of the important task of reclaiming America for Christ.
We need to bring the Word of God to bear on every sphere of life.
One of the things that's interesting about G. James Kennedy, who's a little bit less known than people like, you know, Pat Robertson or Jerry Falwell, but he's right up there in terms of influence. He's probably the third most successful, most listened to Christian broadcaster in the country. He's a proponent of dominion theology, which basically holds that God gave man dominion over all the earth, that dominion was forfeited after the fall, but then restored to Christians through the death of Jesus. And so essentially, dominion theology holds that Christians have a right to rule. And that's something that D. James Kennedy has made very, very clear in his writings.
I believe that the Bible gives us two mandates that are the basic tracks upon which the train of the church and the train of every Christian life are supposed to run. The first one is found in the first chapter of Genesis, verse 28, where God tells us that we are to be fruitful and to reproduce, to multiply, to replenish the earth, and to have dominion over everything on the earth.
Reclaiming America for Christ means a nation that tries to follow God's word, tries to do what God has told us we should be doing, and trying to bring God back into the country again. They're trying to outlaw him in our pledge. They're trying to outlaw him in our schools. They're trying to outlaw him in our monetary money. They've banned the Ten Commandments, which is what we're supposed to live by and which the law of this country was founded on.
In fact, If you go all the way back to the very beginning, you see there was the influence of Christ. Columbus declares in his diary that it was the Holy Spirit moving in his heart according to the prophecies of the Old Testament to take the gospel of Christ to the new world.
One of the things that I think is really interesting about him is that he serves as a kind of a bridge between the, you know, ready for primetime Christian right and the real kind of fever swamps.
Do you feel like Satan is at work in the United States right now?
Absolutely. This is the, and one reason why I think he is because I do think if all the biblical prophecies are true, then Satan knows his time is short.
In other words, in the generation that sees gays march out of the closet, declaring openly their sin without shame, to that generation, there's to be an understanding that you're in the last throes before great judgment comes.
There is a spiritual war. It's an unseen spiritual war. That's what we've been told. We have been told that the God of this age, speaking of Satan, has blinded the eyes of unbelievers so that sometimes when you're talking to them, they don't even realize what they're advocating is really quite dark.
This is from a book called The Changing of the Guard, Biblical Principles for Political Action by George Grant, who used to be the executive director of D. James Kennedy's Coral Ridge Ministries. And he wrote, "Christians have an obligation, a mandate, a commission, a holy responsibility to reclaim the land for Jesus Christ, to have dominion in civil structures, just as in every other aspect of life and godliness. But it is dominion we are after, not just a voice. It is dominion we are after, not just influence. It is dominion we are after, not just equal time. It is dominion we are after. World conquest. That's what Christ has commissioned us to accomplish. We must win the world with the power of the gospel, and we must never settle for anything less."
The second rail upon which the Christian church and every Christian life must run is the last commandment that God gave to us, which is the Great Commission, or the evangelistic mandate, which is to go and preach the gospel to every creature. We find in Ephesians chapter 4, it says that they that were scattered abroad went everywhere preaching the word. Everyone went everywhere evangelizing, and that's how the early church conquered the pagan Roman Empire.
Once we reclaim it here, maybe we can be more effective around the world, because much of the world has gotten away from God, gotten away from Christ.
I want to first of all express appreciation to Dr. Kennedy for the invitation to be here. For me, this is a personal treat. It goes back more than 30 years ago when I was a seminary student in Fort Worth, Texas. And the curriculum that we had for evangelism class was the program that he created called Evangelism Explosion.
The only hope for anything, for this world, is the gospel. The only hope is for people to know that if they were to die right now, they would go to be with God in heaven.
But I'm happy to report to you that last year in FY05 was the highest year in history of chaplains recruited to the United States Army.
I think it's quite appropriate for us to proclaim our faith, and for those who are of a faith group that we believe one must have a spiritual experience, a born-again experience, an opportunity to accept and receive Christ into their heart, into their life, that the military is a perfectly fine setting in which to do that.
Well, the war of terror, I think, has really brought things to the focus. And many people say that the Muslim God and the Christian God is the same God. I like the thought that it says that the Muslim God requires you to give your son to die for him. The Christian God gave his son to die for you.
Well, it's a clash of cultures. It's a clash of civilizations. Do we want to go back to 8th century Islamic law, or do we want to enjoy the blessings and fruit of Christian liberty? And I know where my vote is.
I'll charge you with my bare hands, and I'll scratch, and I'll claw, and I'll fight until one of us is dead, but I am not going to quit. You and I
time has come and is long overdue when we need to reclaim America for Jesus Christ. And I say that without shame and without apology, and we should say, yes, we want to reclaim America for Christ.
Ordinary sequence of human behavior undergoes a radical change so that it no longer exists in its earlier form. What exists, according to an apocalyptic vision, is some kind of utopian purification, some perfect society that has supernatural sources, is given from God, or if in political form, is given by a certain absolute political truth and political movement expressing that truth.
For we must consider that we shall be as a city upon a hill. The eyes of all people are upon us, so that if we shall deal falsely with our God in this work we have undertaken, and so cause him to withdraw his present help from us, we shall be made a story and a byword through the world.
Dr. Kennedy and Dr. Falwell, Pat Robertson, all of these people, we stand on their shoulders today, and the successes that we enjoy have come at a great cost to many of these great men. Rick made a pretty strong assertion last night, and I want to follow up on that. He said that apathy or indifference to these civil matters among the people of God is nothing less than what? Sin.
You happen to be here in Washington, D.C., the nation's capital, at a time when America is in the middle of not one, but two wars. And it would be an absolute disaster for our democratic republic and for our children and our grandchildren if we lost either one of these wars.
Welcome to the culture war. Oh, some would say it's too strong a term. Well, when you have two mutually exclusive worldviews fighting for predominance in the human heart, how else would you categorize it? In fact, let me give you a job description. If you were to ask me, what do? I would tell you that I am a war correspondent in Babylon.
Scorned by a succession of adversaries, multiplying miraculously. The liberal left still doesn't understand where we came from. We multiply miraculously. The more they afflict us, the more we prosper and grow. And I'm here to tell you, if you think 2004 was something, we have not begun to reach critical mass. We are the largest special interest group in America today, and for far too long, our values have trampled underfoot. But somebody's going to join me this morning and shout, silent no more.
What has happened is that Americans have now turned in favor of four basic things: group sex, homosexuality, infidelity, and unrestrained sexual hedonism.
In traditional military terminology, when a soldier abandons his post, he is AWOL, absent without leave. The problem with American Christianity today is that we too are AWOL, absent without Lord.
Listen to how Jesus is proclaimed today. You'd think he'd be some tie-dye shirt-wearing, headband-wearing, long-haired, pot-smoking hippie. That's not who Jesus is. I say Jesus was the most intolerant person in the world.
You know, I kind of feel like the Levite whose wife, who concubine, got abused all night. And she was, you know, in Judges 19, she was abused so much all night that she was killed. And what did he do? He took her body home, cut her up, 12 different pieces, put her on 12 different donkeys, and sent a message to Israel. Look what happened in Israel. This is God's place. Look at what happened here. 3 days later, 400,000 soldiers, warriors showed up and said, come on, let it never be. This doesn't happen. Not here, not in God's place. This does not happen here. We're going to take some action. And they were full of righteous indignation.
So my admonishment to you this morning is this. Sound an alarm. A spiritual invasion is taking place. Secular media never likes it when I say this, so let me say it twice. Man your battle stations. Ready your weapons. They say his rhetoric is so inciting. I came to incite a riot. I came to effect a divine disturbance in the heart and soul of the church. Man your battle stations. Ready your weapons, lock and load.
If you believe that you can create a society, a Christian society, that will allow Christ to return on earth, and that to do so is not only to be obedient to the will of God, but obedient to the laws of history, which you believe to have discovered in the Bible, then you become a very potent and powerful and frightening force, because there is no other way to go forward. All those who do not embrace this eschatology, this vision of a Christian nation, are to be ruthlessly shunted aside because they are agents of Satan.
Only 4% will be Bible-believing Christians in your generation. That means 96% are living outside of the cover of their Father, the Father in heaven, and they're living with the pigs. They're surrounded by sin.
You have real live pigs in the SBC park with you. Looks like they're having a good time, doesn't it? Hanging out with pigs. God is waiting for us to turn and get out of the pig pen. Run as fast as we can away from it.
if you're ready to leave the pig pen, you say, I'm out of here. I'm going to die to myself. I'm going to take up the cross and follow me. This is what I want you to do. I want you to stand to your feet one at a time and shout as loud as you can, I want the cross! One at a time, jump to your feet, wait for your moment one at a time and exclaim, I want the cross! And in doing that, and in proclaiming that, you're putting to death the old self.
It's for a good cause, giving us something to live for, something to work for, giving us hope, changing the stress of daily life and giving us an output for it, and it just makes everything feel a lot better and just fixes everything in our life.
Like, just like the battle for our souls, like, it's like a constant fight, and just like how you need to, like, be training an army to be strong and stuff, that's like play so much part of the spiritual world too. Like, if we're praying, if we're reading the word, if we're like doing God's will, then we're going to be strong, and like that whole the force that's fighting for us, like God, it's going to like strengthen that. Just like in our army, like, we have to train our troops and make them strong, and because I believe it's part of the spiritual war as well. Like, just everything that's going on, it just seems to tie into like the Bible, just like Israel and like all that too, like everything that's happening, it's just like good against bad almost, kind of like Satan and God, you know.
Now those Babylonians, you know, you watch on television today, you know, they're still cutting heads off over there. They're still crazy, wild. And it's no difference between those Iraqis today than those Babylonians were thousands of years ago.
Really, Christianity is one of the only religions, I think the only one, that actually respects the rights of the people who don't agree with them.
You don't feel that something right now. You don't feel there's a city here to take.
Die, it's just going to send us to the place we're aiming to be at anyways. So the sooner we get there, the better. And if I die in the right cause, you know, isn't the word called a martyr or something?
There's over 1,000 studies that show the more violence you see on television, the internet, movies, the more likely you are to be violent. 1,000 studies. How many more do we need before somebody starts doing something about it?
Let's go.
Because I believe that no man left on a battlefield is the way that we need to live our lives as believers.
These people are making a profit off of pouring violence into our kids, like these video games that teach them how to commit murders, how to plan murders. What's up with that? Is that entertainment?
Totalism could be understood as the psychological equivalent of totalitarianism. It's a totalitarian realm within the individual, so to speak. We are the creatures who know that we die, and this can create the most intense impulses in a quest for some form of immortality, symbolic or literal, and that can lead to totalistic behavior. And we have a much longer period of dependency in our childhood than any other species. And that leads to tendencies toward dependency that can be very extreme in adult life, and toward following gurus, and susceptibility and vulnerability to totalistic movements.
God, I pray that your Holy Spirit would descend on this place
and fire and power would well up in a new generation, and they would take the generation back with your power and your life tonight. Would you just commit to your God, whatever it takes, oh God, to reach my generation. I am your man, I am your woman. Whatever it takes, tell them that tonight.
All this stuff is shaping these kids for the sake of a buck.
Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for allowing us be part of your family, Jesus. Thank you for allowing the money that we have to be used in an eternal way. Now, just with your eyes closed, Lord, ask him, Lord, what would you have me give? What do you want me to do, Lord? Okay. Take that envelope, and if you want to receive your gift, you just put it in the envelope. If you want to use your credit card, you can use that envelope. Give like you're giving from your friend's wallet. If the bucket's coming by and you're not done filling out your registration form for next year or your envelope, just hold on to it as it comes by. Finish filling out and put your stuff in there. We're going to continue to worship the Lord as we do this. Ushers, if you go ahead and pass the buckets.
Warfare mythology for the advancement of religious ideology is, I feel, highly inappropriate, because I come from a place where warfare is very, very real and has very real consequences. Being an officer from Strategic Air Command means that we understood that a very bad day could result in nuclear holocaust. That's a reality that we lived with every day. And when you do live with that reality every day and you take upon yourself some small part of responsibility for that and for trying to make sure that that doesn't happen every day, then you become, I would say, rather put out with people who would trivialize these kinds of dire consequences for the world in order to advance a particular religious perspective.
Air Force Captain Melinda Morton joins us now from member station KCFR in Centennial, Colorado, and it's good of you to join us today.
Thank you very much.
You were one of those people who brought up these complaints. How serious is this problem in your view?
The issues that we brought forward, that there was the institutionalization of this kind of pervasive evangelism at the academy, that is to say that people were using their power and their position as Air Force officers, as faculty members, as Air Officers Commanding, and as advanced and senior cadets to engage in proselytization and to inform others that the only appropriate way that they could resource their spirituality was from the bucket, if you will, of conservative Christian evangelicalism. The Commandant of Cadets, General Wyda, engaged in rhetoric and verbiage and sent out commander's guidance, which talked about how people ought to resource their spirituality.
He equated the militarism of conservative Christianity with the militarism that he expected from his cadets, the warrior attitude that he expected from his cadets.
Thank you.
and you're 18 years old, and you're in the United States Army, and your platoon sergeant tells you you're going to go to services, or if you're Curtis Weinstein, my son, who was being called a fucking Jew and being accused of total complicity in the execution of Jesus Christ, get out of my face, sir or ma'am, it's not an option.
When people in the military, whether they be chaplains or staff or people of authority in the military, articulate a religious perspective which says, if you are not born again, you are going to hell. If you do not view Jesus in this way, then you are going to hell. What you are really saying to that person is, now your life and your existence is also of lesser value than someone who embraces this ideology, the ideology of the conservative Christian.
In January of 2005, a brown bag lunch was held at the Academy, as they often are. Today's luncheon topic, it was attended by hundreds of officers, why we cannot let you have your God while we have ours.
My training is in pastoral theology, that is in pastoral care and counseling, and that's what I was brought in to do. And so we were particularly looking at how did the chaplains use their religious training to work to provide care for these cadets. And one of the things that we did see was a confusion between pastoral care and evangelism. In a great big Protestant worship service, one of the chaplains encouraged the cadets in the midst of a sermon to go back into their bunks and to proselytize, to exhort their bunkmates, their colleagues, that if in fact they weren't accepting Jesus, that they would burn in the fires of hell. The other example that we saw was on the days when there were a variety of worship services, basics who chose not to go to the worship services, they themselves were put into a formation and marched around the encampment. They were called the Heathen Flight.
702 U.S. military installations scattered around the world in 132 countries, each of them like a city or a town. And on every one of them now, we have something called an Officers' Christian Fellowship for the officers and a Christian Military Fellowship for the enlisted folks. Number one goal, we want to see a spiritually transformed United States military. Number two, with ambassadors for Christ in uniform. Number three, empowered by something called the Holy Spirit.
Hello, I'm Major General Retired Bob Dees, Executive Director, Campus Crusade for Christ Military Ministry. The vision of Campus Crusade Military Ministry is to transform the nations of the world through the militaries of the world.
And so we're finding, just like the revival in the Army in Northern Virginia, 1862-63, there's incredible numbers, about 1,000 a month, out of the recruit training camps that are coming to Jesus Christ, and then many more recommitting. Why is that? Threat clears a man's head. And God is using this particular point in time to purify those individuals in the military as they go to do our bidding, and also, providentially, to purify our nation.
Well, Colorado Springs is a center for evangelical fundamentalism. The large evangelical organizations that surround the Academy are extremely powerful, not only in the local community, but on a national level, have very much a national outreach. These organizations and others, and there are scores of these organizations in Colorado Springs, also have interest in influencing faculty and staff as well as the cadet population at the Academy.
Is America passive in God's eyes? No. All the way from Genesis to Revelation, you see that God does have opinions about nations. If God's pleased with the government, he rewards it and he blesses it. If he's not pleased with the government, he withholds the blessing and withhold his favor on that government. So do I believe God has his hand on America? Yes. Do I believe God will continue to have his hand on America? I think that's up to us. And do I think it would be wise for us to do the things for God to continue having his hand on America? I think that would be wise.
An Air Force chaplain who chose to baptize Air Force members in Saddam Hussein's swimming pool and chose to have photos taken of this and have those photos published to make of that some kind of publicity event which projects to the world that a Christian American army is inhabiting an Islamic country and performing Christian rituals in the palace of the former dictator of that country, the former Islamic dictator of that Islamic country, I think says very concerning and disturbing things. And then for the military to tout that activity and to laud that activity and to award that chaplain the designation of Air Force Chaplain of the Year is mind-boggling to me, quite frankly. In the military, the kinds of extreme training that you go through are justified by saying, after all, these are matters of life and death.
Soldier, ready your weapon. Enter the shoot house and engage enemy targets. Okay, soldier, advance to the next door.
The same kind of justification is used in Christian fundamentalism in terms of saying there is this kind of ultimate cosmic warfare going on. So I am willing to commit myself wholly to these Christian principles just as I wholly commit myself to this rigorous military life, which justifies a certain kind of intensity and radicalness. The goals of my nation are the goals of God Almighty. And God Almighty will make sure that that the will of the sovereign God is fulfilled through the action of this nation.
As you know, 9/11 changed everything for the United States of America and changed things in the world. So as we train our soldiers to fight the war on terrorism, the spiritual nature of this battle is very important. It is very important at this point in time, when our nation is under this terrorism threat, that our moral fabric be stitched tightly together so that we are able to fight this war on terror on all fronts.
We've got to bend our knee as a nation, we've got to repent as a nation, and we've got to start heading in the right direction. The soldiers, troops and their families have an incredible influence over culture at large. We take in the sons and daughters of America and we bring them into the military forces, and they are mentally transformed, they are physically transformed, and in God's providence they can be spiritually transformed. If we can influence the military for Jesus Christ, we can influence nations, regions, and continents for Jesus Christ.
I want you to understand that God loves warriors. I wear the uniform of this nation. By definition, I'm a warrior. I heard the voice of God. And I can see God's hand in everything.
And I pray they will be comforted by a power greater than any of us, spoken through the ages in Psalm 23. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for you are with me.
During this time when our nation is at war, it is especially thrilling to hear that over 1,000 young people accept Christ every month at our U.S. basic training locations in the United States, and that future leaders of our military are being reached and discipled at the academies and ROTC detachments and at operation locations around the world. I'm impressed with your goal to change continents for Christ. As we move forward together in helping to fulfill the Great Commission, let me encourage you to continue fighting the good fight as you seek to bring faith to the foxhole, hope to the home front, and carry the message of Christ to the ends of the earth. God bless you.
If God does not judge sin, God will become a liar. If God does not judge America, he will have to apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah.
And in the same way as we see these events and the world happening and the increase in frequency and they get closer and closer together, these are signs of the times the Bible tells us to be looking for to alert us to the fact that Jesus Christ is coming back again.
Earthquakes, wars, rumors of wars. We're living in the final days before eternity, and the end could overtake you sooner than you think.
All you have to do is turn on the evening news to understand that a cataclysmic drama is about to be played out in the theater of world affairs. You and I are living right now, this moment, in the days of the fulfillment of Bible prophecy, days that prophets like Isaiah and Jeremiah could only look forward to.
John Hagee today, going into all the world, making disciples, teaching believers the uncompromising message of Jesus Christ.
A sewer of drugs and divorce and homosexuality and pornography and Satanism and suicide and incest. And we're on the slimy slopes sinking down. This is not progress, ladies and gentlemen. What we are experiencing as a nation is not progress.
Plus, with shockwaves of violence spreading through the Middle East, is the erupting warfare a prophecy of Armageddon? What ominous signs convince these people that the end of the world is upon us? A lot of Christians are convinced that the apocalypse may be coming soon. Take a look at the Rapture Index on the World Wide Web.
So, gentlemen, from books to blogs to the back pews, the buzz is all about the end times. Do I need to start taking care of unfinished business and telling people that I love them and I'm sorry for all the evil things I've done?
Well, I think that would be a good start.
As you watch this tape, I can only imagine the fear and the despair that you face. For this is being recorded for viewing only after the disappearance of God's people from the earth. The fact that you are watching indicates that you have been left behind.
'9/11 was a wake-up call to America. Suddenly, now we realize we're vulnerable. And that fear can lead many people to Christ. We believe that God has raised up America to be a tool in these last days to get the gospel to the uttermost parts of the earth.
The Bible has taught for over 2,500 years that the focus of the world would be on the Middle East. And the nations that are in conflict today are the very nations that are talked about in the Bible 2,500 years ago. The first book we wrote was called Left Behind. That's the series. We're trying to make sure that people accept Jesus while they have an opportunity so they don't be left behind. And the interesting thing, Robin, is that all across America, in fact, around the world, many people are calling on the name of the Lord and being saved because there's no alternative. You either accept Jesus or you're going to go through terrible times.
As my mom often says, better get right in these times that we're living in.
Intuitively, in the heart of every human being is the desire to live after death. And we have the answer, not from our words, but from the Bible. And we've just fictionalized it and made it so popular, it just caught on.
It has caught on, over 60 million worldwide. Gentlemen, always a pleasure to have you here and for your insight. We really do appreciate it.
How sweet the sound
wondering if there's any way for me to get a roster or anything like that.
A what?
A roster of event participants.
I'm sorry, no. It is a private event. Yes. What's on? Oh, can you turn that off?
I was doing a documentary and was interested in, you know, talking to a couple of people if I could. Hi.
Are you with the group here?
I'm interested in just getting some basic information about the group. Is there anyone I can talk to?
Unfortunately, they asked us to walk you down. I apologize about that, but they don't want to be to talk to you or anything. You're welcome to wait in the lobby, but you can't be up here. That's all right with you.
Is there anyone who represents the group that I could talk to?
Well, the young lady, she represented a group. She don't want you.
But the camera needs to be off right
or,
now.
Or you can turn the camera off right now.
Would you like
to
have a copy?
Sure.
Have you heard of them asking for a list?
What kind of list?
For the CP. You run a list of the people in-house.
Yeah.
We can't tell you anything about it. If you'd like to speak with someone on public relations, we can transfer you to them.
That would be great, yeah.
Let me see if I can get in touch with.
I asked you nicely. Now I'm going to escort you out. Obviously, you don't want to... Go.
Get your hand off the
back. I respect everybody's views, but I want to like this.
Unfortunately, it has to be like this because there is...
Thank you all. Let me begin first by extending my greetings from the President of the United States. George W. Bush is a feisty guy. I want to ask you a question. I understand that you just recently took a trip and you went on a bear hunt.
And what does that have to do with anything?
Well, I thought it was a liberal bear.
It's a dead one now.
So do you have a bear rug now?
I don't have a bear rug yet, but I will. Those of you who don't like hunting and that story offends you, get over it.
Complaining we haven't found weapons of mass destruction, which of course we have. We just haven't found the stockpiles. We're in the middle of a war with Islamic fascists, and we get word games from liberals. Now it's anyone's guess as to whether we'll find the stockpiles of WMDs before liberals find the right to sodomy in the Constitution.
And dear friends, until Moses comes down with two stone tablets from Brokeback Mountain saying we've changed the rules, let's keep it like it is.
Let me start with the first and most important principle that I want to raise tonight. America is defined by its relationship to God.
We have a responsibility before God. Think about this. He gave us the authority and dominion over this earth as man. We are the landlords. And then with the fall of Adam, we lost that. But with the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, we regained that authority once again. God cared so much about this authority that he even wrote the law with his finger.
It is perfectly legal for you
to call your church to register, vote, and get him and get informed. And on the moral issues, let them scream, but there are biblical applications to all of them. Just go back and preach your Bible and then do what it says to do. But if hell breaks out, just look to Jesus.
History is going to write about us. They're going to say, who were the Christians, who were the leaders when the train went off the tracks and it ceased to be a dominated Christian culture? Or they're going to write and they're going to say, who are the Christians, the moms and dads, the people who voted people into office, the right people into office, that when they saw the train was about to go off the track, they rose up like a mighty army and they said, no, not on our watch. We will not allow this. This is God's place.
Folks, be of stout heart. Be confident. We're close. We're very close to winning these battles. And ladies and gentlemen, if men and women like you all over America will put Christian citizenship at the top of the list of your responsibilities, then soon, very soon, we will be able to come back to Washington, congratulate each other, and know with certainty that we have done our duty and that we have given our children a shining city upon a hill.
Dr. James Luther Adams, my ethics professor at Harvard Divinity School, told us that when we were his age, he was then close to 80, we would all be fighting the Christian fascists. The warning given to me 25 years ago came at the moment Pat Robertson and other radio and televangelists began speaking about a new political religion that would direct its efforts at taking control of all institutions, including mainstream denominations and the government. Its stated goal was to use the United States to create a global Christian empire. It was hard at the time to take such fantastic rhetoric seriously, especially given the buffoonish quality of those who expounded it. But Adams warned us against the blindness caused by intellectual snobbery. He was not a man to use the word fascist lightly. He was in Germany in 1935 and 1936 and worked with the underground anti-Nazi church known as the Confessing Church, led by Dietrich Bonhoeffer. Adams also reminded us that American intellectuals and industrialists openly flirted with fascism in the 1930s. Mussolini's corporatism, which created an unchecked industrial and business aristocracy, appealed to many American industrialists at the time, who saw it as an effective counterweight to the New Deal. Adams finally told us to watch closely what the Christian right did to homosexuals. He had seen how the Nazis had used values to launch state repression of opponents. Hitler, days after he took power in 1933, imposed a ban on all homosexual and lesbian organizations. Adams warned us that gays and lesbians would be the first social deviants singled out by the Christian right, and we would be the next.
We'd heard there was a gay park up in Kansas City. One of our guys had been raised in Kansas City, so I was gonna take him with me. Got up the next morning, Sunday morning. This guy said, well, while we're trying to figure it out, what God's gonna show us, how about if I take you to the Baptist church that I grew up in, got saved in? I said, okay. So we went over there and we got to it and I said, are you sure this is it? And he said, yeah. I said, man, I hate to tell you this, it's not the Baptist church no more. What? I said, it's the Metropolitan Community Church, and he didn't know what that was. I said, it's a gay church now. It's the largest gay denomination in the country. I said, this is all homosexuals at this church then. Of course, he got upset. Well, And then we both figure, well, maybe this is the target. I said, well, let's go check it out. We'll take the briefcase in with us. You know, they'll figure two guys were both homosexuals. I said, but now we're going to have to be here for half an hour, so we can't just come in here, set a timer, and leave. You know, take a chance of raising suspicions. They welcomed us in. The women are sitting on one side, the guys are sitting on the other side, and each side is real affectionate with each other. And this was the epitome of everything again that we stood against. And then the music started with this church. It wasn't the same kind of music that we were used to at our farmyard, charismatic, uplifting, Pentecostal kind of stuff. It was just your typical hymnal kind of stuff. But yet I saw people who did what we did in the sense of closing their eyes and lifting their heads up to the Lord, raising their hands up, praying while singing kind of thing, and just worshiping God. And that hit me hard. It hit me real hard of realizing for the first time that these people now are no different than I am. They're trying to find God to the best of their ability and to understand their place in God. And that was no different than me. And how could I possibly do that to people who are seeking Him? I knew the Bible said, if you draw nigh to me, I'll draw nigh to you. It doesn't say, unless you're a homosexual. It doesn't say, unless there's some sin you haven't confessed. It just simply says, if you draw nigh to me, I will draw nigh to you. And these people were drawing nigh to God. So who was I to say that God wasn't drawing nigh to them?
Scapegoating is a byproduct of trying to calm one's fears with certainty. If I can find someone out there on whom I can place all the blame for my confused, chaotic, uncertain life, if I can identify those people, punish them, send them out of town, get them away from me, get them outside my gated community, I feel better. At the heart of scapegoating is irresponsibility. I will not take responsibility for the state of the world. I am going to blame the state of the world on somebody else.
If you think of religion as a language of ultimate meaning, of things that are important in life, and at the deepest levels of human existence is this sense of the kind of struggle for understanding of the self, a struggle for order over chaos, a struggle of meaning over lack of meaning, that then is often articulated in the imagery of religion, the very symbols that we use, a sword or an execution device at the cross, that kind of evoke moments of violence, of tension, of battle. What is troubling is when we implant that image onto the social and political world around us, where we blur that distinction.
The only way you can speak to someone who's fearful is to ask them to tell you the story about why they're afraid, to respect them as human beings, to honor their fear, to find out how they've been taught to deal with fear all their lives. The problem with the poor leadership we have in this country is that nobody is talking about the fact that fear is supposed to be feared.
What was important to Jesus was compassion and mercy. And the Christian right has yet to learn that lesson. So they're intent on that it's easier to judge other people than it is to judge themselves and to purge themselves of their own sins first. That's harder to examine your own self. And the Christian right's not doing that, and that bothers me. And I think, from a biblical point of view, if they're going to talk in terms of judgment and be afraid of judgment coming to America, they might want to consider that judgment would come to the church first. Because that's where God starts the purging, right there, before they get all concerned about everybody else.
God uses his people. He said, you are my battle axe and my weapons of war.
Amen.
We must not be afraid of what's coming, because a storm is surely coming. I thank God that he's beginning to open the eyes of the people, that they might know who he is, that he is Jehovah, God of hosts, who says in the scripture, I, the Lord, am a man of war. He is not an emaciated, weak, effeminate hippie.
They thought Jesus was crazy, too. So if he can do it, we can do it. He's our example.
Okay, so do you want, how do you want, like setting in the library look, or do you want presidential, or do you want aw shucks, or do you want, what do you want? What are you doing here?
Thank you.